All
Hi,
right.
Sunil. Great
Hi.
to have you here today. And thank you so much for joining this conversation with us, Creative First. I just wanted to ask you what your opinion is regarding the broadcast industry. How do you think it has transformed over the ages?
Thank you. For me, television always rocks because it's the screen of the household. And in recent past of last year, when we were under lockdown, the phenomenal growth that TV got because the whole home was glued to the TV set from 5 a.m. in the morning till late hours of the night only established one thing, that supreme. It is not a competitive situation that you want to compare one versus the other, but there is continues to be growing interest in TV. And don't forget, if there are 200 million homes that have a TV set, 100 million homes are still to get one. So the penetration of TV will grow over the next 10 years. And I think the industry as such has proved that it's the best medium to use when you want to go out to the household for mass products as well as for niche products both. It works across age groups, across geographies, across small villages and big cities. I think what's interesting about TV is that it has put in, taken a, the industry has taken a lot of effort to put into place very strong codes of conduct in terms of self-regulations, in terms of policies, and in terms of practices. So you see the robust growth of TV. If you take, we came out of the lockdown and we came out of the full effect of the lockdown or a large effect somewhere in September, October. And October to Feb, there has been unprecedented growth in volume of advertising. Pricing of those spots has also come back. So it proves that it's on the resurgence, it's on the bounce. And I think if you speak to most people in the TV industry, they will tell you that they look forward to a great FY22, which is 21-22.
What do you think are the challenges that lie ahead?
See, obviously, pretty much, as a consumer, an individual consumer, you have a screen for the individual, which probably sits in the palm of your hand. It's called a mobile phone. And you have a screen of the household. I think younger people are probably veering towards content that is catering to them. So there is content being designed for the individual and there's content designed for the home, right? So, and there is great convenience on the mobile if you want to do catch up TV. So a lot of what is watched on the mobile phone is also catch up TV, right? You're out of home and you want to catch up on that news or that information or entertainment or whatever it is. So I think one big challenge will be being able to sustain the attention of the consumer over the next 5 to 10 years, as there are alternate forms of content and content created, right? Two, I think most of the TV industry is operates on a free system. It's not a subscribed channel, and subscription gives those channels which have it great assurance on revenue. At the end of the day, advertising is elastic or relates to the economy and the change in demand supply over there. Subscription is something that once people pay for it, they continuously like to pay for it, becomes a habit. I think these are some of the challenges too. In the case of content, pretty much TV still produces a lot more content than, say, OTT in terms of curated content. I'm not talking of do-it-yourself videos, right? TV is for the household, and as consumers fragment, it's quite likely that there will be different tastes which emerge. But I think the next 10, next 20 years will see TV to continue to remain stable. Growth rates may not be like they were in the 90s, but they will still remain stable. You went off.
So to your point on multiple screens, and especially from the fact that OTT has really grown, especially during the lockdown, do you think if there is a if there's a need for a standardized audience measurement system for VOD?
See, I think globally around the world, the reason why TV came into this viewing measurement of, which was industry-led, is because it came on the back of radio and print, which were the early ones to be measured. And advertisers actually want a more uniform, neutral kind of measurement system, because who pays for all of this is advertisers, right? They pay for the advertising. They pay for what appears on TV as a TV spot. So they certainly wanted something neutral. Now, relative to TV, digital is still in its early stages. While it may be very large in penetration around the world, it's still in its early stages. And I think as time goes by, I believe advertisers advertisers be the ones to ask for neutrality in measurement. As BART, as a measurement body for TV, we're already working towards that. And the pressure point for us is the advertiser. It's not the broadcaster or the agency. And advertisers are saying we want that neutrality, because right now the measurement is restricted to a few big platforms doing this. And then to create a one video world, right, which is TV and digital together, so you can optimize spends. We may be seeing a lot of growth this year in the economy because there is surplus cash in the Western Hemisphere. There was, you know, restricted demand, which is now coming out there. So you may see some growth. But I believe from a point of view, having a fair and neutral play, it will be good to have a neutral measurement process.
Right. So my next question is, you know, with regards to policy, what do you see were the key developments that have taken place in the last 3 years to sustain television viewership with the growth of OTT?
So I don't think there's any specific policy to support or not support. The governments don't interfere in policy for business, right? They create policy in terms of protection of consumer interest, protection of minority interest, and the like. I think India has a fairly robust and open policy in terms of growth for all mediums. We have been a very flourishing democracy, and I think the standards of freedom of speech continue to be upheld.
Okay. So, you know, with OTT and digital platforms come the big data opportunities, as well as highly robust analytics that make the future very viable for advertisers. So can you share some insights on how advertisers still view traditional television broadcasting as a medium?
It's always the first medium of choice when you're looking to sell products, which the way I look at it, what does advertising do? Advertising stimulates demand. It encourages consumption. And without that acceleration of advertising, there is no economic growth, right? Because then there is no consumption. So for mass producers of goods and services, advertising becomes a go-to decision. And then based on the audience and the efficiency of the medium, they will choose between television, print, radio, digital, outdoor, and others. Digital is good when you have very targeted communication, when you are looking for action-oriented communication to make a purchase. Television is great for influencing the audience's mind. It's great when you're looking at mass products. It also works for if you're looking for products which go to men, right? And you want to target, say, an automobile. Then you will look for sports, news, movies, and the like. So at the end of the day, I don't see a drop in advertising. Volumes have gone up. Last 6 months has proven that the volumes continue to rise month on month. Pricing in television is back. I believe advertisers will continue to use them. Yes, there's a change in some of the categories which are using it, and some of those are supply chain issues related. So we've seen a drop in retail. Would have seen a drop in entertainment. There are no movies being released, so to speak, unfortunately, at this point of time. But otherwise, the top 10 players have continued to grow the support on television. The top 10 players account for almost 50% of the advertising amount.
So you were mentioning that there were some categories in which probably the advertising as per the medium must have changed. Do you see, so which are the categories that are moving to digital?
I see growth in commerce and digital services as an increase. Okay. Right. I think there's been a drop, obviously, in travel, entertainment, and retail because of the lockdown and the effects over there. But as far as packaged goods go, mass consumer goods go, the drop, obviously, in housing and financial services to some extent. But I think many of these categories will be back. It's only a matter of, you know, how that part of the supply chain finds its way back. So they will be back.
And what do you say would be the change in mindset with regard to digital, especially given the pandemic where we saw everything shifting to digital?
So there's a lot more content over there. Now, the content could have been created by you on, you know, how to make breakfast, or the content could have been created. It could be scripted, right? Or it could be entertainment oriented or news or information. I think there's a lot big opportunity for content to sit across both TV as well as digital. It may be separate content, it could be different kind of content that sits over there, and that's a great opportunity for content on the digital side.
Right. Okay. What do you think is the future of broadcasting, not just in India, but across the world?
So, you know, when it comes to global sports, we've got the Olympics coming up in July in Japan, and I'm sure it's going to be a greatly watched event. Why is that so? because we didn't have the Olympics last year. There are going to be some new athletes that emerge. There are going to be some who want to prove that they are still the best in their class. And the world hasn't seen anybody else compete together in 5 years now. If you look at the last weekend and what the news is all about is Harry and Meghan Markle. Where did it break? On television, right? So if you look at it, just look at two things, right? A personal story of a royal family. Where does the news break? Where does it get sold for such a high price? On television, right? Next big event coming up is the Olympics. In between that, in India, of course, is IPL, right? And we just come out of one IPL. So I think that globally, television and digital will both continue to play a big role in influencing consumers. The fact is, in India, private TV channels are still priced at a very low rate or are available free. In the Western world, subscription doesn't come as cheap. And therefore, the comparison becomes almost equal, right? That you can compare the price of a TV channel to a subscription in terms of any OTT play. But in India, there continues to remain a large number of channels which are easily to access. We have 100 million homes which are yet to get a TV set. So I'm quite sure there'll be growth, right? You may see some flattening out in certain markets, especially in advertising in the Western world on TV. But no one, people will still buy that physical TV set, even if nothing else, but to watch digital content on it.
Well said. So you once mentioned that Bach truthfully and faithfully reports what India watches. So what is India watching, and has there been a shift in the type of content that India consumes?
Not in a phenomenal way. So, you know, in the sense, you will not see a sudden hockey stick kind of change. Yes, we saw it in terms of when COVID happened last year, everybody went to lockdown. We saw growth in television. We saw growth in news, which was phenomenal. It went up 3 times. We saw growth in kids' content. Ramayana became the most watched show in the world, right? And it was a repeat of 1986. But many people weren't around in 1986. So they were seeing it for the first time in that sense. We saw mythologies come back. Doordarshan became a hugely watched network in that era. So it's TV largely is entertainment. So 50% plus is entertainment. 25% plus is movies. News is about 10% or less now. At this point of time, a little less than that. Advertising reflects otherwise. 25% of the ad volume is on entertainment because more expensive. 33% of the ad volume is on news because it is relatively cheaper. Right. But I think the broad sectors have remained the same. There are new channels being launched and everybody thought there's going to be saturation. I think in this quarter itself, we've got requests from almost 10 broadcasters, 10 new broadcasters for adding channels.
Wow.
I think obviously there's optimism over there. It still works in many large markets, including urban and rural India.
So in terms of type of content, do you see if there's been any shift in the way India consumes content, you know, genre-wise?
The preferences of television will not change so radically because it's a household medium, right? Many people are watching it. And some younger people may be tuning out of TV, but the older and the middle-aged group remains completely hooked and glued to it. I think what we have seen wean off, we saw English movies and English entertainment wean off first. Why? Because a lot of that content was available on digital. And largely speaking, those libraries pulled their content off TV.
Right.
Because they had sold it for a very big price to, quote unquote, certain private digital players. So obviously the content went off first, right? Then other places like music, which went on to audio and video apps, which again went into the digital world, right? But kids has been largely stable. General entertainment across languages has been stable. News has grown. There are a lot more news channels. It's a highly competitive market over there. But channels which have a more speciality, lifestyle, music, they have seen a certain drop because there are other ways to see documentaries. And there's more investment being made in that content. We need to put the investment ratio on the table. Look at the number of entertainment programs that the GECs have across the board, across all languages. No single OTT player has that much of content.
Right.
So there is a lot more, and this is all fresh content. I'm not even talking about the repeat. Right. Nobody else has that much fresh content going out there. So till that balance kind of equates, at the end of the day, content will draw audiences.
Right.
Therefore, I'm saying that there is a large part of catch-up still to happen. There's a lot of novelty. So people are watching things on, you know, how to cook better, how to groom better, how to study, how to educate better. That's a very different medium. That's not available on TV at this point of time.
Got it. Coming back. Go ahead.
And there's a flexibility, right? One is linear. I mean, you can only see this at 7:45 p.m. in the evening, and the other non-linear, you can see it whichever way you want.
So it's a brand new year for all of us. And, you know, we were very curious to understand what's next for Bark this year. What are your big plans?
So we continue to invest in what we call as our broadcast study. Every periodic 15 to 18 months, we go back and look at who's watching television. We reassess the ground. So we are certainly committed to doing that. We continue to invest in our processes and our robust processes. And we are sitting now on the anvil of looking at doing digital measurement, which will probably be available in the market end of the year or beginning next year.
That's great. So to end things on a lighter note, we heard that you dabble in mixology. So what is your favorite cocktail? And, you know, when you're watching a TV show, and what is that show?
So for me, TV is business. So I don't mix business and pleasure together. But if I was to make a drink, my personal favorite is the martini the way I make it.
Excellent. And, you know, just for our interest, what's your favorite TV show?
No. That's a very fatal question. Someone's got a gun already out there on me. That's a very dangerous question. I ain't answering that.
Okay, no issues. And thank you so much for this interview, Sudhir.
Thank you.
A lot. And we shall stay in touch for more information. Sure.